Good morning. Today we are going to introduce you to and help you understand the range equation of projectile motion.
Hey guys.
Hey, Bo.
Hi, Bo.
Flippin' physics.
The range of a projectile in physics means the horizontal displacement of the projectile when the overall displacement in the y direction of the projectile equals zero. Again, the range of a projectile is defined as the displacement of the object in the x direction when the total displacement of the object in the y direction is equal to zero. It might be better to call it the horizontal range because it is the horizontal displacement. However, it is usually just called the range of a projectile. In just a moment, we are going to walk through the equation for range. However, first, I do want to clarify something. Looking at the video that shows the range of the projectile, class, in the y direction, does the ball move?
Yes.
Yes.
Bobby, how can the total displacement of the ball in the y direction be equal to zero if it moves in the y direction?
Oh, right, because it starts and ends the same height, therefore the straight line distance between where it starts and ends in the y direction is zero.
Correct. Now let's look at the variables in the equation. Capital R is the range of the projectile. V sub I is actually the magnitude of the initial velocity vector. These double vertical lines mean the magnitude of the initial velocity. Theta sub I is the initial angle or the launch angle of the projectile. And notice, because you have both the magnitude and the direction of the initial velocity vector, that you do not have to resolve the initial velocity into its components to use the range equation. So the range equation should be read as, the range of a projectile equals the magnitude of the initial velocity squared times the sine of 2 times the launch angle, all divided by the acceleration due to gravity.
Good job holding the ball in the shot pocket, Mr. P.
Thanks, Bobby.
The what?
The shot pocket.
The shot pocket?
Yeah, the shot pocket.
Bo, what is the value of little g, the acceleration due to gravity here on planet Earth?
Negative 9.81 meters per second squared.
Which is exactly why I asked the question, because your answer is not correct. The acceleration due to gravity here on planet Earth is positive 9.81 meters per second squared. I think the confusion arises from the fact that the first time we use little g is when we define the acceleration due to gravity here on planet Earth in projectile motion. Remember, in projectile motion, the acceleration in the y direction is equal to negative g, where g on planet Earth is a positive 9.81 meters per second squared. Therefore, the acceleration in the y direction is equal to negative 9.81 meters per second squared. Again, because g is a positive number. Please remember that. G is positive. Billy, what is the maximum value for the sine of any angle?
The sine of any angle can never be greater than 1.
Correct. The sine of any angle cannot be greater than 1. Now we're going to use this fact to figure out the angle that will give the maximum range given the same initial velocity magnitude. In order to maximize the range equation, we need to set the sine of 2 theta initial equal to its maximum value of 1. So 1 equals the sine of 2 times the initial angle, and we're solving for that initial angle, so we take the inverse sine of both sides, which gives us 2 times the launch angle is equal to the inverse sine of 1. The inverse sine of 1 is 90 degrees, so then we divide both sides by 2, and we get that the launch angle is equal to 90 degrees divided by 2, or 45 degrees. In other words, a launch angle of 45 degrees will give us the maximum range given the same magnitude initial velocity.
So any launch angle other than 45 degrees will give a smaller range, right?
Correct, Billy. That's why we just went through this. Something else. Bobby, what are the dimensions on the acceleration due to gravity?
Meters per second squared. Why?
Because that tells you what dimensions we need to use on the range and on the initial speed or the magnitude of the initial velocity.
Oh, right. The dimensions need to match. So the magnitude of the initial velocity should be in meters per second and the range should be in meters. But what about theta initial? Should theta initial be in degrees or radians?
Correct. Range needs to be in meters, and the initial speed needs to be in meters per second. As far as the initial angle, it can be in either degrees or radians. Really, usually we use degrees. And you need to make sure that your calculator mode matches the dimensions you're using for your angle.
Yeah, I'm always in radian mode after calculus, and I have to switch my calculator to degree mode for physics. This one time, I took an entire quiz in radian mode, and I didn't notice
till... Billy, do you mind?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, so we do have more to learn. So one other thing about the range equation, and it starts by remembering the shape of the sine theta graph. Remember, the sine curve starts at zero, and at 90 degrees, or pi over 2 radians, it hits its maximum value of 1. Then it returns to zero at 180 degrees, or pi radians, negative 1 at 270 degrees, or 3 pi over 2 radians, and then at 360 degrees, or 2 pi radians, it returns back to zero and starts the cycle over. In other words, one full cycle is 360 degrees. However, in the range equation, we have the sine of 2 times theta, which changes the graph slightly. Now, instead of having one full cycle in 360 degrees, we have two full cycles. That means that it takes 180 degrees for one full cycle, or just 45 degrees for a quarter cycle. And you can see the maximum value is at 45 degrees. But that's not the main reason we're looking at this graph. Watch what happens when I put a horizontal line that intersects the sine 2 theta curve at 30 degrees. Notice that at 60 degrees, it also intersects the sine 2 theta curve.
Okay, but what does that mean?
It means that the sine of 2 times theta will be the same for both 30 and 60 degrees. Which means that the range for 30 and 60 degrees will be the same as well.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, agreed.
Hold up. Aren't 30 and 60 degrees called complementary angles?
Oh yeah, complementary angles because they add up to 90 degrees.
That is correct. Complementary angles are going to have the same range. Mathematically, it looks like this. The sine of 2 times the initial angle equals the sine of 2 times the quantity 90 minus the initial angle. For example, if we have a first launch angle of 30 degrees, a second launch angle that will give the same value for sine of 2 theta initial, and therefore the same range given the same magnitude initial velocity, is going to be 90 minus that first launch angle, or 90 minus 30, which is 60 degrees, which is exactly what we got using the graph of sine 2 theta initial. Now, this is a graph that shows the projectile motion parabolas for various launch angles, all with the same initial velocity magnitude of 30 meters per second. Of course, an initial angle of 45 degrees gives the largest range. And you can see that launch angles of 30 and 60 degrees have the same range. The same is true for launch angles of 75 and 15 degrees. Now, while 75 and 15 degrees may have the same range, they do not follow the same projectile motion path. You can see that the larger initial angle will have a higher maximum height, and therefore will spend more time in projectile motion before it returns back to the height it started from. Let's do a quick review. Capital R stands for the range, which is the displacement in the x direction when the overall displacement in the y direction is equal to zero. V sub I is the magnitude of the initial velocity or the initial speed. Theta I is the initial angle or the launch angle. G, the acceleration due to gravity here on planet Earth, is a positive 9.81 meters per second squared. Complementary angles will give you the same range, and you get the maximum range when the initial angle is 45 degrees. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.